the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's a very great pleasure for me to be here today sharing the worship of this church in its 300th anniversary year. I bring the greetings of Canterbury Cathedral, which by now has finished evensong and is settling down to an English tea, but nevertheless has been praying for this church and its worship throughout the day. And it's, I think, a lovely thing, as I was saying earlier, that your prayers are so effective that you've even provided me with English weather today. it's good to be sung into the pulpit with my own hymn words. The first verse was written in the vestry of the Cathedral Church of Christ in Christchurch, New Zealand. It's a church that no longer exists, really, after the catastrophic earthquake. But when I wrote it, it was one of the prime cathedrals of our Anglican communion throughout the world. And I well remember standing in the Mother Church of Canterbury Cathedral on a particular day, about 4 years ago, and thinking that three cathedral churches that I would have thought most solid and safe had been rendered unfit for worship for one reason for another, and we were praying for the cathedrals there. One of them was the National Cathedral in Washington, which had just suffered from the earthquake. One was the Cathedral Church of Christ in Christchurch, New Zealand, which had been more or less destroyed by an earthquake. And the other one at the time was the beautiful granite cathedral in Harare in Zimbabwe, which had been locked against its priests and congregations by Robert Mugabe at that time. And the Christians were having to worship courtesy of other Christian denominations in their own buildings. And as we prayed for them, I sort of felt, well, nothing really is certain in this particular pilgrimage. That sometimes there are great places of strength which become places of weakness for a while, and the places which were seen to be weak become strong and hold the others. It is a very great thing to belong to a worldwide communion, and one of the tasks of the Cathedral Church in Canterbury is to be the mother church of that Anglican communion, to pray for the life of our whole communion. But it is an especial pleasure for me to come to a church like this and feel the vibrancy of its worship on a day when our gospel speaks of great vibrancy in a place where you would least expect it. We sang in our first hymn the lovely line, "And like the eagle, he renews the vigor of thy youth." And you have the sense of great streams of divine strength flooding back into you as that line based on Isaiah's text of "they shall mount up with wings like eagles." The gospel is a story of a blind man who sat day after day on the road which went from Jerusalem to Jericho, or in this case from Jericho to Jerusalem, because Jesus' disciples and he were traveling along the road to get them to the holy city. And Bartimaeus is sitting there. Something in the blind man causes him to know that light is about to flood into his darkness by the one who is coming. How? We don't know. But intuition tells him that this is the one whom God has sent with heaven's freedom. This is the one who will pour that energy into him. You might think, well, yes, of course, he'll have that after he's healed. But no, the story tells us that when Jesus comes and the blind man has shouted, Jesus says, "Bring him to me," he springs up in a way which is full of hope. The word is a glorious one in St. Mark's Gospel. springs up and stands before Jesus. Jesus says, what do you want? The blind man replies, my teacher, let me see again. In a way, the word again is hardly necessary, for the blind man, in a deep way, is already seeing more than the crowds and the disciples. He's seeing the Saviour, Son of David, have mercy on me. And his sight is restored with the wonderful words, go, your faith has made you well. But he doesn't go. That's the best part of the story. All that new energy is going to be used in a different way. For the last line says, immediately he regained his sight and followed Jesus on the way. Not go, but follow. Jesus doesn't say to him, follow me. He sends him in the other direction. Go back home. Enjoy. But no, he wants to follow on the way. And we might spell that way with a capital letter. Because Christians, as you know from the Acts of the Apostles, were first called followers of the way before they became called Christians, first at Antioch. Some of you may know a wonderful film which was made about 4 or 5 years ago called simply The Way. It tells the story of four pilgrims, modern pilgrims, on the Camino to Santiago in Spain. And it begins with a rather affluent Californian dentist who is playing golf and he's semi-retired. He has had no contact with his son for a long time. And then he gets a telephone call out on the golf course to say that his son has been killed in the Pyrenees. He goes there. And he finds that his son had been about to set off on a pilgrimage from the Pyrenees along the Camino to Santiago. And this man, late in life, has no idea why his son would do that. The whole concept of pilgrimage is completely foreign to him. You see him with the police inspector talking about it, and the police inspector hands over to him the casket in which his son's cremated remains are. And he says to the police inspector, have you ever done that? Oh, yes, he said. I say, it's the most natural thing in the world to go on pilgrimage. And I know from being Dean of Canterbury that it is the most natural thing in the world to go on pilgrimage, because pilgrimage in our modern world is growing by leaps and bounds and hundreds and thousands. It's something that people love to do. It somehow shifts their spiritual perceptions and gives them a new kind of energy. The four pilgrims aren't there for very worthy or holy motives, but in fact, when the ashes are given, the father decides that he will effect the pilgrimage for his son. And he takes the casket all along the pilgrim route to Santiago. And with him go three others. And he said, why are you going? You expect a holy reason. And the chap says, well, I'm too fat to get into my suit for a wedding. And so I want to get a bit slim, so I'm going on a pilgrimage for my houses. And then another lady says, I can't seem to break the habit of smoking. And so I'm going on this great pilgrimage to say I'm never smoking again. And they go along with it. And they have rows on the way. They meet people who are good. They meet people who are bad. And I'm seeing myself in Chaucer's Tales, which is part of the stuff of our life in Canterbury Cathedral. And when they get there, they all find their lives have been changed. They all find that they are bonded in a particular way that makes them friends, even though they're, if you'd said, oh, you'll be a friend of her one, no, 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 she's not the sort of person I'd make friends with. No, no, I'd never get on with him, we've nothing in common. But they become friends through the walk. And when they get there, the chap still can't fit into his suit because he's been eating all the way. And the way in which the woman celebrates her by lighting a cigarette as she takes the first puff of the cigarette, you realise she's helping to relax into a new situation. The change is different from what they expected. They go right on to Finisterre, and his son's ashes are thrown into the sea, and he feels he's got to know his son in a completely different way. But pilgrimage does that, and on the way they meet people. When I came to Williamsburg, I didn't know it at all yesterday morning, and Tyler gave us a great tour around, and we met all kinds of people. Some of them were hosts here, dressed either in the clothes of the late 18th century or in modern clothes. And they were welcoming and ready to tell the story of this place. We saw all kinds of things which made us anchor into the story of both the culture of the late 18th century and also the culture which it has resulted in now and forged the United States, and also this community of Williamsburg. What I realized was that I was in a situation very like Canterbury, for we get 1.4 million visitors to Canterbury Cathedral, and they come, some as heritage visitors, and others as pilgrims. And to be honest, it's sometimes difficult to tell the difference between the two, because the heritage visitors quite often turn into pilgrims where they experience what's there. I saw all that happening yesterday, and I felt, God bless this church in Bruton, because it has such a wonderful opportunity. I preached in the church at Bruton in Somerset, and they're in a very quiet spot, and they don't get 1.4 million visitors or all the hundreds of thousands that you get here, but you have a really special location in the 20th century, the 21st century, because you have people coming here, whether you like it or not. Therefore, you have an opportunity which most quiet little churches like Bruton in Somerset in England would die for, because it's frontline evangelism in the most normal way. We in Canterbury Cathedral have as our mission statement the four words, to show people Jesus. And it comes from that bit of John's Gospel where Greek tourists, shall we call them, in the temple courtyard say to the disciple Philip, sir, we would like to show, to see Jesus. And so from that we forged the purpose of the whole life of the community at Canterbury was to show people Jesus. Young men and women carving stone, gardeners at their work, choir singing, daily evensong, docents and guides welcoming and telling all kinds of facts when they begin to realize what interests the people who've come in. And the glory is that you sometimes see, very often see, a tourist turning to a pilgrim simply by the conversation they're having or the space they've entered into. It's the same here. Right into the middle of all these people, Saturday farmers market, and all the heritage visitors, and the docents dressed in the 18th century, here is this church, which proclaims Christ by its very being, and proclaims him also by your very being, and the way you tell your story. We're always like horses pilgrims. We are the people we are, and you know what the pilgrims were like in their particular ways, completely different from each other. But when we tell our story and what brought us here, then we give something of that spring of the blind man. And following Jesus on the way is a compulsive thing to say to people to follow as well. It's wonderful to come here and stand even on an English type of weather morning, and yesterday even better on a Williamsburg type of weather morning, as we saw the people happily sharing the life here. But this church has an opportunity second to none. For when they come in, they get the welcome not only of the community of Williamsburg, but of Christ himself, through meeting the community that has worshipped here throughout those centuries that we're celebrating a 300th anniversary. you sang my hymn, which was written partly in the vestry of that cathedral church in New Zealand, and quite by coincidence, it ends with the words, "Alive with the conviction that Christ can make us whole. We know he can. We've read the story of that light in the darkness, of the springing forward of the blind man to follow him. But this morning, by coming here and stretching out our hands to receive him, we are asking for wellness, for wholeness, and the ability to spring up with vigor, inner vigor, restored, and the ability to follow him along the way. Thank God for this church, and may he give you grace to be followers along the way and Christians along with the disciples."